we continue this, I'm gonna spend the time, and I'll watch my time, because I know I could easily go over, and we'll just stop when we get to the right place on the clock, but I'm gonna continue this idea and kind of finish up this thing and on the preservation of Scripture, and we're just gonna look at some nuts and bolts things in our Bible that to me are very interesting, that are in many ways unique and specific to the King James Bible, that because of the omissions and word changes, etc., etc., you won't find these things in other Bibles. And so it's really interesting. There, I took lots of different notes from different things. Alex Belinget, y'all hear me talk about Alex Belinget. Got Sound Words Ministry, Sound Words Bible Church. That's in front. They meet in, I think, a motel place somewhere there in Franklin, Tennessee, just south of Nashville. They just gotten there. They've been doing a in-home Bible study, but they just organized a local church there, meeting on Sunday mornings. Alex will be at the Bible conference in Gatlinburg, and again, marking those dates and repeating those again: the 28th of March. The 28th of February for the 1st of March. And again, the times, let me repeat those. It's 7 o'clock Friday evening, 11 o'clock Saturday morning, so it'll be midday, probably about 11 to 1. Back in there again at 7 o'clock Saturday evening, and then at 9:30 on Sunday morning. And remind you that we will not be here on, Sunday morning, the 1st of March, we will be there at the Blackberry Inn in Gatlinburg. And that is right there on the main strip. It's directly across the street from Crockett's Breakfast Camp. Go in there, take the elevator, or if you're real energetic, take the stairs, go to the top floor, and they've got a big meeting room up there, and that's where we'll be. And I would encourage you to come to all or a part of that. Debbie and I are gonna stay there. So that we could be there at fellowship and all that kind of stuff with all the folks that are there. So anyway, Alex will be there. Some of this stuff, some of these notes I made listening to Alex. Alex is really, really good on the King James Bible. And if you do Facebook and you find Alex Belinget, find his page, find Sound Words Ministry page. And he records and puts his videos up there, and he's a young man and doing a really good job. They just had their second baby this weekend, and what did they name her?
Charity
May. So it was. The oldest girl is Grace, and this girl is Charity May. May is the month that he and Lauren, his wife, met, was in May, so it's Charity May. Alex, I love Alex dearly. He's a fine young man. He's studied and he's learning, and so I'm just putting it out there for full disclosure in case someone listens to Alex and they come back and listen to me. So yeah, some of this stuff I stole from Alex because that's good stuff right there. I'm gonna repeat that. And so give credit where credit is due. It's also encouraging, while I'm on that note, to see young men. I mentioned that Bible conference that we went to in Op, Alabama. I think that was my first Bible conference of, this sort to preach in at all. And it was most all older men. Me and one younger man, Gilbert Shellen, were the only ones that had any hair on the top of their head. And I made the comment to Gilbert while I was there, when I got up to preach, I said, Gilbert, if going bald is a qualification to preaching these Bible conferences, I may go back to being something else, But the older I get, the thinner it gets. So you may find me in one of those big comb-overs one day. Nothing wrong with going bald. Don't be offended. Don't let that upset you. Several of our men here are bald, and so I want to be careful. I don't offend anybody.
Jack, but, I was just saying, you had two hairs working, foot long. Yeah, girl, look like you had hair.
That's right. Yeah, yeah. And so, but anyway, but it's, the point I was making, it was older men, and so many times we go and we hear older men preaching, and sometimes I'm one of the younger of the older men that are preaching. And so when you see these young men in their 20s and 30s and 40s that are preaching the truth, it's just real encouraging. And so let me just throw that out there. I appreciate Alex for many, many reasons. And his testimony and his preaching and his teaching is just really good. All right, now. All right, so as we continue this on with the time that we have left, I want to do some nuts and bolts kind of things that I hope you'll find interesting. They're interesting to me. Some of this stuff is stuff that I've just known through the years, and other of it is stuff that I got off of Alex and listening to him. And so we're going to start with something I had never heard before, but I got from Alex. The first verse in the Bible, Genesis 1:1. Find the first verse in the Bible and mark that. And then go all the way back, Revelation 22, and I think it's verse 21. Revelation 22, verse 21. And again, it's just interesting stuff as we put this together. All right, Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. All the way back to Revelation 22, 21. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. In the modern Bible versions, in Genesis 1:1, they add an S to heaven. They add, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, we've talked about the doctrinal, why that's a problem before. I'm not going into that. I'm making another point today. But in the modern Bible versions, it doesn't say in the beginning God had created the heaven and the earth. It adds an S. God created the heavens and the earth. In the modern Bible versions, go back to Revelation 22, 21. Our King James Bible says, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. The modern Bible versions leave out the word our. And so they just say, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Well, now here's the interesting thing about the first verse in the Bible and the last verse in our Bible, in our King James Bible. Each one of these, both of these verses, have 44 letters. They have 17 vowels. They have 27 consonants in the first verse and the last verse in our Bible. Now, that, do I think the King James Bible translators did that on purpose? No, I don't. But does that show maybe something of the fingerprint of God? All right, now let me blow your mind a little further. Remember, we talked about 1 John 5:7 earlier today. All right, go with me now to 1 John 5:7. And I'm going to tie it in with Jude 1 or Revelation 22, 21 and Genesis 1, 1. What did I say? 1 John 5, 7. And I'm giving you the information. You can go back and count it if you want to later on. But in Genesis 1, 1, Revelation 22, 21, 44 letters, 17 vowels, 27 consonants. Now you get to 1 John 5, 7, and what do we say that modern Bible versions do? They just omit the verse altogether. And so 1 John 5, 7, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. Well, here's the interesting thing that Alex pointed out about 1 John 5, 7. There are 88 letters, there are 44 vowels, there are 54 consonants. So you take the first verse of the Bible, the last verse of the Bible, that has 44 letters, 17 vowels, 27 consonants, and then you double that and have 88 letters, 44 vowels, and 54 consonants, And the verse that does that is 1 John 5:7. Just an interesting thing with the Bible numerics there. Something we pointed out many times, and I want to say this before we go a whole lot farther. Go with me to John chapter 3, because this is one of those places where it is important to understand. Again, people comment about, as we've even noted earlier, King James Bible's hard to understand. And whenever whoever goes to update, bring into modern language the archaic words of the Old English of the King James Bible, which reality is, use the term Old English is incorrect. It's not Old English. Do a little study on what Old English really is. Some of the language is archaic. We don't use it like they did then. But one of the first things that folks want to do when they want to update or modernize or put into modern language is they want to take out the these and thous and the ye's and all that kind of stuff, right? They don't like the these and thous. But now, make a note. I've told you this before. But remember this, because when you're studying, it can make a difference in understanding what's being said. T pronouns, and the King James translators did this on purpose. T pronouns are singular. Okay? Thee, thou, thine. Singular. The Y pronoun, ye, you, where the Y is used, it's plural. And they made that distinction on purpose. Now go with me to John chapter 3. And let's see, where do I want to go? Which verse is it? I didn't mark it, so... Marvel. Yeah, here we go. Verse 7. And we could read that. And you know, John chapter 3, it's Jesus talking to Nicodemus. Let's just read several verses. Start at verse 3. And pay attention to the T pronoun and the Y pronoun. Verse 1, chapter 3, John. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher, come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest, except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, who's he talking to? Nicodemus. Thee, singular, Nicodemus. Marvel not, or Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus saith unto him, How can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Now verse 7, and this is why I want to point out real important. Marvel not that I said unto thee, Nicodemus, ye, who?
You.
Ye is who? Who's he talking? Well, number one, it's plural, right? Because it's a Y. And so Nicodemus is a master of who? Israel, right thou? Isn't that right?
Yes.
Art thou a master of Israel and knowest not these things? Notice Nicodemus said in verse 2, we know that thou, who's that? We, that's Israel, the leaders, the scribes, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, no, those guys. We know. So you've got that multiplicity. And so when you get to verse 7, marvel not that I said unto thee, Nicodemus, ye, Israel, must be born again. And he goes on down through there with these information, and I'm not going into the doctrinal of all that, but pay attention to what it says as you make that distinction between the T's and the Y's. Well, now, that's a very important doctrinal point. Jesus told Nicodemus, don't marvel that I say to you, Nicodemus, as a master of Israel, that Israel must be born again. Now again, when we understand dispensational truth, we know that today we are not born again. Okay, that's a term that's used. The only one who uses that term are apostles of Jesus used it, and the apostles of Israel used it. Israel is born again. We know that there's coming a time at the second coming of Christ when those dead bones, right, of Ezekiel rise again, and Israel then is born again to go into the millennial reign of Christ. Now, we can go on and chase that rabbit and talk about that doctrine, but I want you to understand that it's important to pay attention here at verse 7. Marvel not that I said unto thee, Nicodemus, ye Israel must be born again. Yes, sir.
If he was speaking to him as a singular, you must be born again, what would he have said?
Thou.
Thou must be
born. Marvel not that I say unto thee, thou must be born again. So you pay attention to those T's and those Y's. And so as you and we read through there and we don't pay attention to that.
Well, there's plenty of talk about that.
But you got to pay close attention to the T pronouns and the Y pronouns and how that affects the doctrine that's being taught. And so we are new creatures in Christ and all that stuff. We're ambassadors of Christ. We're saints of God and all that. But we're not born again. That's a distinctly Jewish term that's a reference to Israel being born again, being born a second time to go into the kingdom. When was Israel born the first time? We studied it all. I know I'm chasing the rabbit just a little bit. Israel was born the first time, and the Bible tells us back there when they came across that Red Sea, that's when Israel was born as a nation. That's when they become that firstborn. But what happened with Israel? They died. And Israel has to be born again to go into the kingdom. Now again, that's another doctrine, but I want you to understand there's a difference there between the T and the Y of John chapter 3, verse 7. All right, so as you study, that's a King James Bible thing that you do away with when you eliminate the these and thous and thines and the ye's and the you's so pay attention to that. All right, now let's look at a couple of other things. I'm not going to give everything about these things, but I am going to give just a few things. Bible numerics, it's interesting study. Bible numerics, and we're going to look at just a couple things. The number one, what do you suppose one is used for in our Bible? Okay, a beginning or it's a unity. One is unity. One represents unity. And I won't go through all the different references there. Just put out the word. One represents unity. There's union in one. If one is unity, then two becomes what? Division. Adam was one. And then in Genesis chapter 2, God put Adam to sleep and took out of him a rib and created a woman. Was there a division there?
Yeah.
Adam was divided, and now there's two. Okay? So two is a number of division. If you go to Galatians, and again, don't go there. I'm just going to rattle in some of this. But you go to Galatians chapter 2 and all these numbers, and then you go to verse 7. 7 is the number of completion, perfection, completion. So you go to Galatians chapter 2, division, verse 7, and when you go to Galatians 2, 7, guess what you find there? They saw that the gospel of the uncircumcision was committed unto me, as the gospel of the circumcision was unto Peter. What do you got in Galatians 2, verse 7? What do you got? The distinction, the division between Peter's gospel and Paul's gospel. A lot of things you can study about that. All right? Unity is one. Division is two. Number three in our Bible is division in unity, or unity in division. So we bring it back together. We have the Trinity, right? 1 John 5, 7. There are three that bear record. If we're going to refer to Jesus Christ, don't we say the Lord Jesus Christ? Three. You got the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. When we talk about time, what is time? Past, present, future. We go to our Bible. Time past, but now, ages to come. Man's made up of what? Soul, body, spirit. When we think of space, we have breadth, width, height. I guess breadth, width, height. All those different things, and you can go on and on with that. So three is when one is unity, two is division, three is when you bring things back together, unity. And you could do a threefold cord is not quickly broken. I'm not going to quote it right, but you could go on and on. Let's talk about the number five for a minute. I'm shuffling my notes as I'm rattling through here. Go with me to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 5. Acts is what book in our Bible, or in our New Testament? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's the fifth book. And go to Acts chapter 5. Go to verse 5. And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost. And great fear came on all them that heard these things. What happened to Ananias in verse 5? What did he do? He died. So 5 is death or dying. Go all the way back to Genesis chapter 5. Genesis chapter 5. And guess which verse? Genesis chapter 5, verse 5. And all the days that Adam lived were 930 years. And what did Adam do? He died. This is the first time a man dies in the Bible. Now you say, wait a minute, what about Cain and Abel? Well, did Abel die or was Abel murdered?
Murdered.
He was murdered. Now, did it take his life? Yes. But that's different than he died. So Adam lived the length of his life and he came to the end of those years and he died. Genesis chapter 5, verse 5. And all the days that Adam lived were 930 years, and he died. Let's see. Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. Verse 6, for when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. Verse 8, but God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Going down through here, Verse 10, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved from his life. Verse 12, wherefore, as by one man entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. And you go down through here, verse 14, death reigned from Adam to Moses. Verse 16, 17, where we at? Well, you get the idea that we're talking about dying. Romans chapter 5 has a whole lot about dying and death and the death of cross, the death of Christ for our sins. I can take you to several other places where in battle it's recorded that they struck them in the fifth rib, death. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 24, Paul says that he was whipped how many times? 5 times. All those are interesting things about the word five. Let's talk about the word, or the number 6. Again, this was something here that I'm going to give you that I got listening to Alex. When you talk about modern Bible versions, the commonly used modern Bible versions in the New Testament, he gives the references where the Lord is left out 12 times, Jesus is left out 15 times, Christ is left out 25 times, God is left out 14 times. You add all that up, and guess what number you come to? 66 times. The Lord, Jesus, Christ, God are left out of our New Testament in the modern translations that deviate from the King James Bible. 66 times. Go back to Revelation chapter 13. We knew we were going to go here. Revelation chapter 13. First of all, it's Revelation chapter 13. We all know 13 is a lucky number, right? 13 is always associated with something bad. So Revelation chapter 13. Then we're going to go to verse 18. And 3 times what is 18? 3 times 6, 6, 6, 6 is 18. And all that dwell upon the earth, yeah, verse, where am I at, 13, 18, I'm sorry. Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 600, 3 score,
and 6,
which a score is 20, so 3 score is 60, so 600, 3 score, 60, and 6. Again, interesting. What day was man created back in Genesis? On which day? The sixth day. And so kind of where we're going with this is 6 is the number of man. 5 is the number of death. 6 is the number of man. Here's something interesting. Go with me all the way back to Ezra chapter 2. Ezra chapter 2. Because this 666 comes up a couple places. Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job. And let me get there. What did I say? Chapter 2. Ezra, chapter 2, verse 16. The children of Adonikam, 666. And I meant to write down the definition, and I didn't, the word of the name Adonikam, but it's a bad reference. Anybody have that handy, Adonikam, what it means? But the children of Adonikam were 666.
It's the Lord of Rebellion.
What's that?
The Lord of Rebellion.
The Lord of Rebellion, thank you. I knew, I just didn't write it down, and I couldn't bring it up. So the children of Adonikam, and it means what?
The Lord of Rebellion.
The Lord of Rebellion. The children of the Lord of Rebellion, 666. And we're in Ezra chapter what? 2. Division. Verse 13. Always something bad. And you got the Lord of Rebellion, and his children are 666. You think that's an interesting thing? And again, if you start taking verses out and add verses in and change his words around, then you lose all that stuff. All right. What else do we want to go? 2 Chronicles chapter 9. Back to your left again. 2 Chronicles chapter 9. We have this thing turns up again. 2 Chronicles chapter 9, again, it's verse 13. Now the weight of gold that came to Solomon in 1 year was 603 talents of gold. Again, 666. And I'm sure that you could dig around in there and find out something about how that all connects. Just interesting stuff there. The darkness that came upon the face of the earth during the crucifixion of Christ, when did that darkness begin? It came about the
sixth hour.
Luke 23:44. All right, let's see what else we want to do. Sevens, the number of completion, we said. What day was it that God rested?
Seventh.
The seventh day. How many days in a week? 7 days in a week. How many colors, primary colors, are there? Seven primary colors. How many notes on the piano? Seven notes. Well, what about the black keys? Well, they're half notes, right? Do I have that right? You piano players? Seven notes. And we could go on, and you know, you could study your Bible and see those sevens that pop up. Eight is the number, if seven's completion, then eight is the number of new beginnings. So you can study through and find eight, and the different places eight and multiples of eight comes up. Nine is the number of fruitfulness. There are, in Galatians chapter 5, there are nine fruits of the Spirit. It was in Genesis, and I'm rushing through for time-wise here. It was in Genesis 9:9 that that first covenant was established. Abraham was 99 years old when God established the Abrahamic covenant with him. 10 is the number of the Gentiles. Go to Romans chapter 10. And what is Romans chapter 10 all about? Romans chapter 10, and I didn't want to go to Romans 10, I'm sorry. Skip that. Bad note. All right, let's go on. Number 12 is the number of Israel. Okay? Genesis chapter 12 is when God calls out Abram, who becomes the father of Israel. It's Exodus chapter 12, where Israel comes out and are born as a nation. Number 13, we said, was bad. If we go to Revelation chapter 17, there's 13 words that describe the harlot. There's 13 letters in Judas Iscariot. The dragon, that old serpent, the dragon is mentioned 13 times in Revelation. And anybody remember that name back in the Old Testament of Nimrod? Old Nimrod back there in the Old Testament, guess what generation he was from Adam? The 13th generation from Adam. 40, what do you suppose the number 40 is? 40 is the number of testing. 40 days, 40 years in the wilderness, 40 days of the temptation. We see 40 repeated over and over again. You see 70 a lot of times, 70 years of captivity, and we could go on and on and on. 1,000. Mankind in the ages a lot of times are divided up into thousands. Well, we could go on and on. One day is with the Lord as a 1,000 years. 1,000 years is one day. And some of that may be boring to some of you, but it's interesting to me how all that kind of puts together. We talked earlier about the middle verse of the Bible, Psalm 118:8. It's better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. And the middle two words are the Lord. Well, all these are interesting things that, and most of these things are things that are unique and specific to our King James Bible. I'm going to stop with this part of the Bible study, and we're going to, you know, I'm not going to carry on with preservation of Scripture, because you can just, it's like all these other things. You can dig and dig and dig and dig and more and more and more. As I said, I got lots of books out here that you can read and take and consider if you're interested in the subject. And of course, there's a whole lot of material available that I don't have right here. But Brother Sam, why are you spending the time here? Why is this important to you? Because, you know, if I can persuade you to understand that this book is not like any other book, and God had His hand on giving us this book, and if you approach this book as I believe and preach and teach that it is, the very words of God, every word like God wants it to be, and if you believe what you read, where you read it, considering what they knew at the time, who was the writer, what was his mission, ministry, who was the audience, what were they being told, how much information did they have, and believe the words on the page, you'll come to understand Pauline dispensational truth. I can remember, Forrest, you'll appreciate this story, and then I'll tell this story and I'll be done. Jack Hiles, who's was the pastor of First Baptist Church of Hammond, he's gone to be with the Lord now, built a humongous mega church among the independent Baptist churches, bus routes all over greater Chicago, and you know, all that, big influence. Jack Hiles came under the wing as a young preacher of John R. Rice. You heard me tell you, John R. Rice preferred the New American Standard Version over the King James Bible. Well, John R. Rice, Jack Hiles became Jack Hiles because of John R. Rice and his influence and mentoring and taking him out around the country on the Sword of the Lord conferences and all that stuff. As long as John R. Rice was alive, Brother Hiles never took a stand for the King James Bible. Never did. As soon as John R. Rice died, Brother Olof got a hold of Jack Hiles and said, "Okay, Jack, it's time for you to take a stand on the King James Bible." After John R. Rice took a stand, after John R. Rice died, then Jack Hiles came out and made a public stand from his pulpit and in his ministry and in his church about the King James Bible being the Word of God. I used to listen to a lot of Jack Hiles tapes back in those days. And as I would listen, I remember I told Deb, I said, if they're teaching the King James Bible, and they're really teaching that, somewhere along the line, somebody's going to come to understand some Pauline truth, and they're going to understand that there's more than one gospel in the Bible, and they're going to understand all this stuff if they believe the King James Bible, and they start teaching that. Well, back in those days, and I know it was illegal, you're not supposed to do it and all that, but back in those days, as we would travel, we had one of those big old vans, you know, that, you know, whatever they call them, customized vans, and the kids could ride in the back, very comfortable. I had a cassette tape player, and I'd put the headphones on, and I'd listen to preaching. We're driving down the highway one day, and I'm listening to that, and Jack Hiles is preaching. He says, "I'm going to put a stop to something right now. If there's anybody preaching out there at that college that there's more than one gospel in the Bible, I'll chain the doors and padlock the place and close it down." And I remember hitting the stop button and taking the headphones off, and I said, "Debbie, you ain't going to believe this." You remember that? Yeah. I told you, if they start preaching the King James Bible, somebody's going to see some dispensational truth, and they're going to start teaching it, and Jack ain't going to like it. And sure enough, I'm listening to that message, and here he comes. there's anybody out there preaching that there's more than one gospel in the Bible, we'll padlock the doors. Well, he didn't padlock the doors, but you know what? There were some folks got fired. And why is that? Because when they took a stand on the King James Bible and started teaching and believing and going to the book and believing what it said, where it said it, to whom it said it, they couldn't help but come to an understanding that God told different people different things at different times. And if you don't understand that, you'll never understand your Bible. So Brother Sam, why are you making a big deal out of King James Bible? Because it's this King James Bible that'll bring you to right doctrine. And if you eliminate the King James Bible, you're going to have a tougher time finding right doctrine. And as we've said so many times, and I'll finish with this, if you go to 2 Timothy 2:15, which tells you to study, to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth, it don't read like that in those other places. It doesn't tell you to study, it doesn't tell you to rightly divide it. King James Bible tells you to do both. I think that's important. All right. Any final comments, observations, questions before we move along? Is that good? Aren't you glad I'm done with this part?
I hate to throw my head in, but you're talking about other gospels. You know, what do you mean by that?
More than one gospel of the Bible.
Yeah.
And everybody's cringing because they're afraid I'm going to answer you. Okay. Just like it says, and I'm going to give real quick, just like it says in Galatians 2:7, when they saw that the gospel of the circumcision was committed to me as the gospel of the uncircumcision was unto Peter. Okay?
That's two gospels.
That's two gospels. Okay. Okay? Now, there are more, there's, what I need to do is steer you to the YouTube video where I taught this, and I'm doing it on the radio right now. By the way, I'm going through the more than one gospel in the Bible on the radio at 5:30. Okay? But I can take you to where we did it here and take you all the way through. The gospel that was preached by John the Baptist, Jesus, and his earth ministry, and the 12 apostles was the gospel of the kingdom. It was not the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. It was the gospel to Israel about a coming kingdom. That gospel continued to be preached even in the early Acts by the apostles. No one preached the gospel of Christ, the gospel of the grace of God, until Paul preached it. So there's many gospels in the Bible. We commonly refer to the two because that's where people get all mixed up. We want to say, everybody saved before the cross, we're saved looking to it, and everybody saved after the cross, we're saved looking back. And I'll say everybody before and everybody after, no one goes to heaven without the cross. But Adam didn't know anything about the gospel. Noah didn't know anything about the gospel. Abram didn't know anything. Moses didn't know anything about the gospel. The prophets didn't know anything about the gospel. John the Baptist didn't preach the gospel. Not the gospel we preach. That's the important part. So there's more than one gospel in the Bible. Then Paul says in Galatians 1, he says, the gospel which is preached of me is not after man. I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it. Paul didn't get his gospel from Peter, James, and John. Mm-hmm. Then he goes on to say, but by revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we could go on, and people want me to stop now because they know if I get started here, I'll be another 3 hours. But let me find that video and send you the link to the video that I did here. I did it here over 2 or 3 lessons. And I actually boiled it down to just one lesson, the Bible conference in Chattanooga last year, I think. But I'll help you with that. More than one, and that's an important distinction to understand, too. There's more than one gospel in the Bible. All right, anything else? You're looking around saying, don't you dare ask me. All right, thank you for your attention, and let's have a word of prayer, and then we'll sing our song.